two lays and a crow per day. I am the little red rooster.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today we have a special guest, Mr. John Good, who goes by John, so that's how I will address you now. Good afternoon, John.
Good afternoon.
So thank you very much for writing me a very detailed account of your career, your military career. And what was interesting I see is that you were drafted. If you wouldn't have been drafted, would you have thought about joining the military, or?
I don't know. I was married fairly young, and I was working and going to school and had a lot of things going on. A lot of my family was in the military. My father was in for 30 years.
Wow.
My uncle was in for about the same. I got other cousins and, I had an opportunity to go to one of the academies, and Marines approached me while I was in college and said, if I went to Quantico for the summer, I could graduate as a lieutenant. And, so there were a number of things on the table, but I just didn't. I grew up in the military, so I was a little tired of it in a way.
Now, one thing interesting about you is that I'm sure there are many, you're a tall man. You're 6'6".
No, 6'3".
Oh, 6'3". I'm sorry. It says 6'6" here, but we should have left those extra 3 inches for you. But did you play sports at school?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I played basketball, football, baseball. I was a pitcher in baseball, so first base and pitching.
So were you?
Yeah, I played a lot of sports.
And so that you were into playing team events. You were a team.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
So you go to Fort Jackson in Columbia, South Carolina, and then it says here that, of course, if you wanted to go to West Point, you had to be single, and at that point, you knew that you weren't single.
Yeah.
So and then. Very similar to Bill, who we had on earlier, you were sent to a place to become a pilot, a helicopter pilot.
Yeah, that was one of the interviews I went to. That, a data processing school. I don't know why data processing school, but.
So would I be right in saying that if you had good grades or good marks, that they would think that you were, a candidate to be a pilot or to be?
They set those interviews up based on the initial test you take when you come in into the military, and you're part of your in processing process is to take a battery of tests, and then from those, they pull your aptitudes out,
right? And they go from there, eh?
And I didn't want to be a pilot. I decided pilots seem to have a short lifespan.
If you only knew, right? If you only knew the reality. So now, it being 1967, the Vietnam War is in full swing, and you're hearing it on the news. Your parents are watching it. I'm sure anybody else who served in your family's going, oh my God, John is now in the military. So were they fearful for you, or were they like, of course your mom's concerned you're going to the military, but.
Well, like I said, my family, a lot of my family were in the military. So it wasn't that big a stretch for me to end up in the military too. So, and it's oddly enough, after I got in, I really enjoyed it. So,
well, I'm sure having a father who was in there, that you were probably very used to like a regimented routine anyway.
Yeah, you grow up in the military, and it's almost like you are in the military. What you do is. You mess up, it reflects on your father, that kind of thing. So, yeah, you have to kind of toe the line.
And so then you have the opportunity. I see your cat sitting in the way.
Yeah, this cat.
That's okay. It kind of adds to it. We'll add some kind of cat content. I'll get mine on my lap too. It'd be good.
She's just nosy. She's got to get into everything.
Oh, I know. But they're good friends, though, right?
Yeah.
And so, okay, so you have the opportunity of becoming a pilot, and that wasn't for you because that you were concerned about the lifespan. You know that, you know, there's a lot of men who aren't coming home from the war, which is in the news already. So what made you go, or what attracted you to special forces?
Well, they actually had a special forces recruiter as you came into the shed where all these interviews were taking place. And when I walked in the door, they pulled my 201 file out and opened it up. And he was standing there behind the guy, and he was 6'6". Wow. He was a big guy wearing strange looking fatigues, which turned out to be jungle fatigues.
Right.
You didn't see them in the States back then very often. And so he just reached over this guy's head and plucked my file out and said, "I want to see this man when he's done with the other interviews," and gave it back. And I thought I'd done something. I said, well, thinking, what did I do wrong? So I went to the Special Forces interview, and there were about, I don't know, 30 or 40 people in the room. There was, I don't know, several hundred of us that were processing through, right?
Right.
And so he started out with basically saying, "I'm going to ask one question. Would you be willing to jump out of a perfectly good airplane while in flight?" That's exactly what he said.
Wow.
And, you know, he asked me, he came around the room, he asked, and I said, "I'll try anything once." And about half the room left.
Really?
Oh, yeah. That sorted out about half the room. And then he went through his spiel about SF and what they did and the training you'd have to do, and, you know, kind of laid it all out. And I already knew, I'd seen, I don't recall them having PBS back then, but some sort of a TV special a few years before when I was in high school about special forces, not long after Kennedy had come and kind of adopted them and whatnot. So I had a little understanding of them. And so when he finished his spiel, everybody else in the room left except me and one other guy.
Wow.
And he said, you know, "You have to take this test." And I said, "Fine." I said, "If what happens if I pass? What am I obligated to?"
Right.
He said, "Nothing." He said, "If you pass," he said, "then you have the opportunity to try and get into special forces." So I said, "Yeah, I'll take the test." Strange test. All kinds of questions. They'd present you with a scenario and then give you a selection of choices, and you had to pick the best one, the worst one, and then try to rank everything else in between. Another one was, another part of the test was kind of visual orientation. So you would see a picture. I remember one particularly of a train yard. All right. Picture was probably taken at high noon because it was very bright and you could see all the buildings clearly and the tracks running all over. Flip the page and it showed another picture of the same place from a different direction at night. And you had to pick out the targets. All right. And this was all done. It was driven by a tape recorder, a reel-to-reel tape recorder.
Right.
And so, you know, you could take as long as you wanted on a question, but the tape recorder wasn't going to stop it. You had, you know, and your times got shorter and shorter on some of the things. So you'd start out with a minute to make your choices. And then,
then
for each one, it got a little quicker,
pressure.
A little quicker. So it was it was a long test. I think it was around 3 hours or so.
Mm.
And so anyway, it turns out I passed, the other guy didn't.
Now, just to go back a step. Now, you were willing to try anything once, which included you jumping out of a perfectly good airplane. So my question to you is, as a child or teenager, did you take risks? Like, were you doing jumps on bikes, or were you jumping into streams? I mean, it seems to be that your personality would dictate to me that you probably had scars predating Vietnam.
Oh yeah, I had a few, but none. They were all survivable, so yeah. Not a big deal. But so I passed, and so they said, okay, if you want to try, but what you'll have to do is, they brought me into this orderly room, and they had two sets of papers. One was a set of discharge papers, and right next to it was a set of enlistment papers. So they discharged me from the military and immediately turned around and enlisted me in the military.
Oh.
Because as a draftee, I couldn't, you couldn't be a draftee and go in.
Oh, really?
You had to be oh yeah.
I didn't know that. Wow.
Yeah. Partly because a draftee was only drafted for 2 years, so you wouldn't have had enough time to complete all your basic, your advanced individual, all airborne, and then special forces selection and training too. So you had to have a minimum enlistment of 3 years just to go to SF training.
Now, this is very, to me, this is very, neat for me, because you're filling in gaps of history that I never knew about. And I have a question. You're not really, so you're trying out for the SF, but like your barracks, where were you, like, are you assigned to it when you first went in, were you assigned to a unit and then you go back to that unit while you're doing these tests, the same base, or like, where are you stationed?
At Fort Jackson.
Oh, okay.
At that time. So I went through basic training at Fort Jackson. And then after that, I went to Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri, for combat engineer training.
And that was your MOS?
Yeah, that was combat engineer. And then I went to airborne school, and I was kind of fortunate in that I was in a very tough basic training unit. All the cadre were Vietnam veterans. They were all had airborne or ranger or some,
right.
So the captain was a PT nut, And when I went to Fort Leonard Wood, the company I was in, while it was a little bit more laid back and we had the weekends off, they were also very much physical fitness nuts. So by the time I got to airborne school, physically, it wasn't that tough on me.
Right.
So I was kind of lucky in that regard.
I'm not sure if you've ever seen that series, band of brothers. And
yeah.
There's that one captain, Sobel, that's his name. And he just runs them up that hill and down and, okay, men, we're going up there again. So that's kind of the mental picture that I get in my mind of some of these PT guys,
Well, I went to airborne school at Fort Benning, Georgia, and in July. And it was extremely hot. They have a tall flagpole, or at least they did then, that if the heat was too high, they would run a red flag up,
right.
And which meant that you weren't supposed to run. Well, the airborne cadre didn't care. They ran us everywhere. But they had these showers on concrete pads, and they would make you lay down with your boots off the pad and roll and you'd roll through these showers. And then every hour they had these big blister bags or water trailers that were had salt added into them. And they would stand, and you would be required to drink a canteen cup, like the military canteen cup, a cup of that while they watched, and to keep hydrated and salt in your system.
To ensure that you wouldn't die.
yeah. So, although we did have in my class one guy that committed suicide.
Wow.
But
was he a draftee?
I don't, I don't know what he was, but he hung him. So we came back, and I didn't really know the guy, but he had hung himself in the shower. So
that's a sad start for all of you, right?
And
especially for the gentleman. So, and here's another side question. When you were to look around at your fellow men there, were there mixed? I mean, were there African Americans? Were there Hispanics? Was there a mix, or was it a mix of nationalities?
In which
part? SF. Sorry.
Basic or SF or
SF?
It was a mix. Yeah, it was a pretty broad mix of people from all kinds of walks of life. We had one guy who toward phase three of our training, I think Bill told you there was a phase one, phase two, and phase three. And phase three, one of the things you were waiting for your security clearance.
Right.
If you couldn't get a security clearance, you couldn't go forward. So this one guy got pulled out of class, and he was, from the Red Hook district in New York, which in those days was pretty rough district. And so he was gone for about 3 days. And when you apply for your security clearance, they have all these questions. Have you ever, did you this, are you that, kind of thing. And one of them has to do with drugs. And have you ever taken or been addicted, kind of thing. Right. With drugs. And he said yes. When he came back, he told us, he said, yeah, they pulled me out, he said, because I had checked off the drug question as yes. He said, because when he was a young teenager, he had been on drugs, and then he got clean.
Wow.
Got cleaned up and straightened himself out, and then he went in the army.
Right.
And so their concern was, they didn't really care that he had drugs. What they were concerned about was that it could be used to blackmail him. If he was in a situation where he had access to classified materials, they wanted to make sure he couldn't be blackmailed. He said, they can't blackmail me. He said, everybody knows I was a drug addict at one time, my family and everybody else. So he said, I don't care.
Interesting. I mean, I see the point now, because I was wondering if you were going to say that the military didn't want to risk someone being, after all that training, being hooked on drugs. But I see what you mean, that it could be used against him or, and for seeking information. So,
yeah, they had a SF in those days was you had a lot of guys still in there left over from World War II in Korea, so. I remember seeing, you've heard of the First Special Services. Devil's Brigade.
Yep.
Well, I remember they had a sergeant major there, in SF, had a black eye patch. I saw him walking around from time to time. And I mean, a hard looking dude. I mean, really hard looking. And the combat patch he wore on his right shoulder was a First Special Services Force patch.
Wow.
He had quite a mix of people in there.
And that's what I was talking to Bill about. Also is that, I mean, in the 60s, they were doing the Lodge Filburn Act, and they would, if you were from Eastern Europe, and you wanted to join the military, they would, there's lots of guys. And I did a story about that in one of my Pucker Factor books. I was amazed, Germans, Czechoslovakians, French, guys from Canada, but that wasn't really rare, super rare. So many other, and quite a few of them, which most people might be shocked at, that they were World War II veterans, as you were saying, right?
Yeah.
So they were already, as you described with that gentleman, they're already hardened men, and with the eye patch too, he had the whole look going on, right?
Yeah. I don't know if you ever heard of Larry Thorne.
Yep. Yep. Finnish guy.
So, he was Finnish and fought the Russians.
Yeah.
And then he joined the German army just so we could fight the communists and the Russians.
Yeah.
And then after the war, he came to the States and he joined the U.S. Yep. Army.
So did you ever meet any of those men?
Some of them, but in the training group, we were kept pretty busy. So
right.
I met quite a few people.
I'm sure.
In Vietnam after, Bob Howard and Frank Miller and
right.
all those, I knew all those guys. So.
Very, very cool. So it says here that you have a funny story. After graduation, since I have my car, and then I will let you finish this. It says,
oh, that.
Yeah.
You're talking about in Missouri.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had my car there. And so we could go anywhere we wanted, within reason. And so there was Fort Leonard Wood there. Back then, there was nothing there. I mean, just nothing. So we heard there was a university down the road about 100 miles. And so the guy said, oh, come on, drive us down there, So we said, okay, fine. I said, and we drove down and these guys were all interested in seeing if there were any girls. So we're driving around and there was an amazing lack of women in the area, it seemed like. And, you go to the drive-ins and like the A&W root beer stands and stuff like that. It was all guys in the cars. And we asked them, we said, we thought there was a university here. And they said, oh, yeah, it's a mining technology school.
Oh, God.
So we had all these guys there for mining technology. So the fellows were kind of disappointed.
Wow. And bet you thought, oh, man, to spend all this money on gas.
Oh, well, gas was cheap back then.
How much was gas, do you think? Or what is the cheapest that you can think back to? It doesn't have to be Vietnam.
The cheapest gas I ever recall was about, actually cheaper than that. Well, it ran when I was in New Mexico in high school, it was between 25 and 27 cents a gallon. And then occasionally they had had these price wars and it would drop lower. And then you'd get the ranchers come into town with their truck, the back of their truck full of 50 gallon drums, and they'd pull in and just,
really?
Fill up as many of them as they could. So, but it was 25, 27, 28 cents like that back then.
It's funny because I'm 53 and, I feel that I'm old, but I know I'm not, but I can think back to when gas was 53 cents. So that's,
I would take that.
Yeah, me too. Okay, so we've got phase three done. So then you were initially told you'd be going to the 10th Special Forces. So you've entered the Green Beret, you've got your Green Beret, and now you're going to be assigned to a group. Is that correct?
Well, I had, when I was out west in high school and first 2 years of college, I did a lot of skiing.
Right.
All in New Mexico, up in, there was a place called Sierra Blanca, not far from where we lived in Roswell at the time. And so I used to ski all through the area, did a little racing, some slalom racing and whatnot. So when they found that out, they said, well, I would be a good fit for the 10th group. That's how that came about, right? So I was all for it. Sure. Let's go to the 10th group. I was all for, go skiing and rock climbing.
All those fun things.
And, then all of a sudden that changed and they said, well, no, we're going to send you to the 8th group in Panama.
Okay. Yeah.
And I thought, well, not much skiing there, but all right. And in the end, I ended up getting assigned to the 3rd group right there in Fort Bragg.
Right.
Which was area of responsibility was Africa. And in those days, there were so many mercenaries running around Africa, they didn't really need us. And we came with too many strings attached anyway. So they actually were phasing out the 3rd group. Okay. And so that's when I got called in and told I was going to
I know what you mean. As a sidebar, that I know that in Africa during that time frame that you were saying that there was lots of hired guns. And I know that a lot of the German SS guys went to Africa. You know, either they joined the French Foreign Legion, and they were very well, you know, some of the best trained soldiers in the world. So I don't mm-hmm. doubt they didn't have a problem finding a job, right?
Yeah, no, there was plenty. I almost, after I left Asia, I almost went to, I knew a guy whose father was in the Rhodesian Defense Department.
Right.
And he said to me, he said, well, I can get you into, you know, and get you in the Slusi Scouts.
Right.
And they frown on that back in the States, you know. And he said, don't worry. He said, your passport will never show you were there.
So, wow.
But in the end, things were going downhill at that point down there. So it would have been a very short engagement.
So what for you, you were with the third. And so what is the segue between FOB two? How were you offered it up? Hey, would you be interested in an assignment? We can't tell you what it is.
No. Sergeant Major called a number of us in to his office, and he said, I've got some good news, bad news. And he said, the good news is you're all going to Vietnam. You've all got orders for Vietnam. Okay. What's the bad? If that's the good news, what's the bad news? But actually, everybody, it's a funny thing. When you go through training like that, at some point you want to test your training.
Oh, yeah.
Right. You kind of, it's one of those things. Anyway, so he turned to me and he said, good. He said, you've been assigned to MACV SOG. That was the bad news. And so I said, what's that? And he said, you'll find out soon enough. So at that point, I started asking all over the place, anybody know what MACV SOG is? Anybody, no, I don't know. Or so finally somebody said, go see Chief. And he was a Cherokee Indian. And of course, his nickname was Chief. So he was up in the photo lab, and I went up and I asked him, I said, what's MACV SOG? He said, why? I said, because I've got orders for it. He said, then tell them you want to go to the Central Highlands. And that's all he told me. So I said, okay. So I got to Vietnam, processed in, went through to the fifth group, and went into the Sergeant Major's office there. And he had a big whiteboard behind him with A camps and assignments and whatnot. And he said, I see you trained as a radio operator, which I did and I hated, but I said, yeah. And he said, I got lots of spots for you and A camp. He said, you don't have to go up to SOG. I said, well, I said, I think I'd like to go up and see what it's all about. He said, okay. He said, but you can always change your mind. I said, okay. So the next day I caught a blackbird up to Kontum, me and another fellow. Got picked up at the airstrip. We got there about noon, midday, and came in, and he dropped us off outside what turned out to be Recon Company headquarters. There was a flag pole there. And so we're sitting on these concrete steps around the flagpole, and some guys come walking by. And one of them, I had Jeff, got name just jumped away from me. Anyway, we'd gone through training group together. And he hollered at me and said, what are you doing here? And I said, I don't really know. I just got here. So they were going to lunch over in the mess hall. So we went over. And afterwards, I went to see the first sergeant, and he had a similar whiteboard up behind him with assignments and stuff and vacancies. He said to me, he says, where do you want to go? And I said, well, my buddy Jeff, he said, everybody is in Recon Company. He said, I should sign up for Recon Company. They said, are you sure about that? And I said, yeah, sure. I said, that's where all my friends are. So he said, okay. He said, He said, you can always change your mind, though. Everybody was always telling me, yeah, I could always change my mind. So anyway, I got assigned to recon company, and my first team was RT Arizona.
So just to interject, did you, and I hate to ask, but did you fill the place of a man who went home, or was he killed?
I believe that was, they were just shorthanded. Okay. Nothing. I wasn't replacing anybody. Right. They were just shorthanded. There weren't that many of us, I found out.
Oh, really? You
know? Yeah. I mean, I read somewhere there were only a total of 3,000 SOG operators, right, over the course of its existence. So a pretty small group.
And now that team has quite a bit of a history, that several members of it were killed probably prior to you, right? And one of them is still MIA unaccounted for. But that was prior to you, right?
Prior to my getting there, yeah.
Yeah. So it says here, got my gear sorted out, and we went on my first mission right to the Ho Chi Minh Trail.
Yep.
So was that the first, I mean, obviously I wasn't around then. Did they mention about any, like, back home in the U.S., was there any talk about this trail, the Ho Chi Minh Trail, or was it the first that you'd heard of it?
Well, no, I'd heard of the Ho Chi Minh Trail.
Right.
But I didn't really have a real picture of it in my mind.
Right.
But it was a road. Yep. It was part of a network of roads, hard packed, graded. They used they had bulldozers and road graders, and they had regular maintenance on the road. So, and it was patrolled quite regularly. So it was a little bit of a surprise when you look down there and see this, maybe not paved, but it was about as hard as a paved road.
I know that the Bill was very quick to tell me that, just to be clear, it wasn't a trail.
No.
Was a proper road.
Yeah. They had a network of them. I mean, it wasn't just ace. I mean, everybody talks about the Ho Chi Minh Trail, but it was really a network of roads through which they brought supplies and men and material down. And some of them were pretty well concealed. I found one in an area one time on a mission that before we went in, they said, there's nothing in there, but we need somebody to go in and have a look around. Yeah, but a real quiet area. And so we thought, sounds like an easy thing. So we took the whole team. So there was about 4 Americans and 8-9 mountain yards. And we came across this. We probably hadn't gone more than 300 or 400 yards, 500 yards off the LZ. And we found this area that had lean-tos and shelters and whatnot. And I saw what appeared to be a trail. I was about 30 yards away, 40 yards away. And I said, there's a trail. Let's go over and look at it, check it out. And it was a road, and it had curbs on it that were, it was bulldozed and graded and hard packed. And you stepped off like 6 inches onto the road, and you looked up, and it was all concealed, overhead netting and interlaced branches and everything. You couldn't tell it was there. And about then a bunch of NVA came. We heard a bunch of people coming, and we hid behind some brush, and about an 8-man NVA point element came strolling into that area. And so we ambushed them, got into a bit of a fight. One of the Americans got injured slightly, and so we had to get pulled out. And we carry these pin double E cameras,
right,
the Intel people would give us. And you got one? So, yeah. So they would give them to us preset. And so I never messed with them. I just took it out and took pictures, right?
Right.
Gave it to them. And after we had debriefed, they came back and they called us back in. They said, we got a couple questions. You told us that you found this bivouac area and there were troops and you got into contact and found this road. I said, yeah. I said, we took all these pictures. And somebody said, but there's no pictures on the camera. Nothing came out.
Oh, man.
I said, I don't know what to tell you, but it's there. And they implied that they didn't believe us and really, really pissed us off.
Wow.
And so about a day or so later, I was walking across the compound. This young lieutenant came up from one of the hatchet forces. And he said to me, did you go into Oscar 9 or whatever it was? I said, yeah. And he said, can you show me where you went in on the map? And he had this, you know, standard kind of map, 1/50,000 kind of map that we carried. So I found it and I found the coordinates and everything, pointed it out to him. And I said, why do you need to know that? Out of curiosity. He said, well, we're going to insert a reinforced platoon. And I told him, well, if you're going to do that, I wouldn't use the same LZ that we went in on. I said, you might want to give it a rest and come in a different way. And he said, he got real shirty and he says, I said, I tell you what, if you like, I said, I'll get a couple of my mountain yards. I'll get my point man and a couple of them. And I said, we'll go in with you and your platoon and we'll lead you to the area. And he said, oh, he got really kind of ticked me. He said, well, we don't need any help and like that. It was kind of an odd attitude, I thought. But so I said, well, up to you. And so they did. They went in and made a bunch of rookie mistakes. For one thing, they went in late in the day and they used the same LZ we had used. And he'd even asked me, can you show us how you traveled? And I did. They followed they just kind of walked in our footsteps all the way. And that night they got hit by the NVA and took something like 85% casualties.
Oh,
so they believed us then.
That's sad. That's sad. So just to take a little step back, when you saw the NVA, that was your first experience with combat. Is that correct?
No. I had been at 1-0 then.
Okay.
Quite a while then.
Oh, I see. Okay. All right.
No. I'd been shot up and shot at.
Okay. So you weren't a cherry at that. You were no. a seasoned guy. So it says here, with the same team, Cambodia that you went to. Spoiler alert, I always like snake stories. So Bill had one, and I like your one too, because I like to, mix the stories up. I don't want to plague the veteran with, LZs and all that. I mean, there has to be a little bit of, lighter stories.
Mine was a little bit different from Bill's. There were four of us went in, me, one other American, and two mountain yards. We were way out there in a NVA division base camp. And we were wearing North Vietnamese boots, Bata boots, right. So they couldn't track us. And anyway, we were going all, we moved a lot at night. And so we had placed some booby traps and stuff and we were stopping for the night. And we laid down and I always slept. I had this roll. It was half poncho, half what they call indigenous blanket. It was a nylon and flannel on the inside sewn together. So put the poncho liner down on the ground and flip it over. Yeah. And a lot of people don't realize, but it gets cold in those mountains at night. I've seen ice in bomb craters up in the those mountains. And so I would always sleep with my gear. I didn't take it off, but I pushed it up.
Right.
So it was behind me, and I could kind of use it as a rest point, a pillow, if you will. I slept with my car 15 down along the side of my right leg with my hand on it and with the nylon that flipped over from the left. And I was laying there, and I felt something on my, like on my elbow, on my left elbow. And I started to move, and then all of a sudden I felt this thing come slithering right up over, and it was heavy. And I thought, oh my God, it's a snake. And so I just froze, and I was barely breathing. I was trying not to move at all.
Right.
And I was thinking, running through different things in my head, but my bolo knife was right here. I thought I could grab my bolo and but you couldn't see your hand in front of your face.
Yeah.
And I thought, I probably cut my foot off or something. So the same with shooting, they wouldn't know, the other guys wouldn't know what was going on. I'd probably get shot by them. So all I could do was just lay there and frozen. And so dawn came, and the other guys were getting up and starting to move around, and come on, get up. And I was like, I'm laying there going, snake. What's the matter? Snake. And finally they got the idea, so they all got around and grabbed the corners of the thing and whipped it off, and there was nothing there. So it must have just kept on going. And I figured, given the size of it, the weight, there were only two really possibilities. One was a rock python, a fairly decent size one. And the other was a big cobra, because the cobras over there could get quite large. And I saw one in Thailand one time that was, I was standing there and it was behind glass, and it was literally eyeball to eyeball with me. And they claimed it was the largest one in the world. I don't know if it was or not, but it was large.
Yeah, like, and 12 feet long. Huh? Or something. Some of those can get to be 12 feet long.
Yeah. So I think this one's something like 18 feet. And so they can get quite large. And so that was, then we had another run in with a snake. This one's kind of funny in a way. We were on a patrol and going along, and my point man, he turned around and he said, snake. And I looked over, and there was one of these bamboo vipers. We were going through a bamboo grove, and he had twined himself around this stalk of bamboo that was probably so big around, right? And it was right in the sun, and he just kind of twined himself around about head level.
Great.
And he was just kind of, hanging out there in the sun, soaking in the sun, right? So I turned around and I pointed and I said, snake. And so, as people went down the line, so we went on a bit farther and we took a break. And my 1-1 came up to me, a guy named Ron Maddox. And he says, why were they telling us to sneak back there? I said, they weren't telling you to sneak. They were telling you there was a snake there.
Wow.
He never even saw it.
Was that one of those two-step snakes? I know that they had.
No.
A different
That's
type.
A crate. That's a crate. Banded crate.
I mean, there's so many. I think that people who read these magazines or books about Vietnam, they don't realize that there's lots of things in the jungle that want to kill you. I'm not talking about the enemy. There's lots of poisonous and.
Yeah, there were some, say centipede. They were bigger.
Yeah.
They were things about like that size, And we were going up on this wiretap, and we were sitting there taking a break. And I had a tear in the inside left of my pant. And all of a sudden, it felt like somebody had taken and put a hot poker on my leg. And I was, you know, I couldn't holler or anything. You know, so I'm cursing somebody. I said, "What's the matter?" I said, "Something bit me." And we see this thing scurrying off, right? Well, we killed it. And I had this spot on my leg that right at the center of it where the bite was, it was white, just a real white. And then a big red ring around it, you know, farther out. And so I took a bunch of Benadryl and whatnot, and we kept going, right? And when we subsequently got chased out of the area for a couple of days, but back at the medic shack in Canton, I went into them and I said, showed them the bite, and I said, it was some kind of big centipede thing, and they had all these big jars up around on shelves in the wall and with formaldehyde, and each one contained a different kind of critter, right? And he said it was one of those, and he pointed out the thing that bit me, and I said, yeah. He said, well, you obviously don't have any bee allergies. He said, because if you did, you'd be dead.
Wow. And anaphylactic shock, eh? Wow.
So, but yes, there was the tigers were real, into one of those one time, elephants. Not like African elephants or the Asian elephants, but they could still step on you pretty good.
Right.
So there was lots of stuff in the area.
Wow. I just, you know, I haven't been to Asia. I've been to West Africa and went on some kind of safari. So, but that everyone thinks if you go to Africa that you can see all the big five, and you know, they're not all in the same place. So monkeys, I saw monkeys, you know, like that. Yeah, no big things, but it was an experience. So can you explain to some of the people who are listening about what a wiretap is?
They had these these devices that you would find found a communications cable, usually a coaxial type cable, and it had these prongs that you could put into it, and it ran back to this device that would pick up whatever was coming across the wiretap and could also record it. So sit back, and the interpreter had some headphones he could plug in with and listen to what was coming across. So I was setting up my radio because I was carrying the radio at the time, and we'd put out security, and Ruff is out in the trail burying a toe popper. He says, "We'll try and take a prisoner," right? And the interpreter's listening on the headphones, and he said, the interpreter taps me on the shoulder and he says, "They know we're here."
What?
And I said, "Yeah." I said, "They probably know we're in the area somewhere." He said, no, they know we're here. They say, you send out a QRF from your side, we'll send one out from our side, and we'll catch them in the middle. They knew we were tapping the wire.
Oh, wow.
And which we had been assured that wasn't possible. So we had security out on both sides, and I had a line, a long piece of lightweight string that I had tied to my foot. So if they saw something, they could give it a jerk, right? And I was I was hollering at Ruff, who was still out in the trail. I said, Ruff, come on, get back here. And my foot goes, bang, like jerked off to the side.
Wow.
And all of a sudden, claymores started going off. And Ruff comes running back, and things are going off. And I was behind some brush. And so I'm trying to get my radio gear back together, right? And I looked, and the team's gone. And I look over at the other side and I see a line of NVA coming through the brush. And I look the other side and the team had pulled back. And so I'm in the middle.
Oh, God.
And I'm just hidden, screened by this brush. And no, they don't, our team could see me, but the NVA couldn't see me. And so I'm hunkered down there and they're saying, okay, on three. And they went one, two. And I jumped and they opened up full blast. And I jumped up and ran and took a dive over a fallen tree and made it. B-40 went off on the other side and we had to blow our gear and we took off running. Fortunately, there were some A1Es in the area that Covey had. And so they started strafing and bombing the ridgeline behind us. So, but they chased us for about 2 days. And we were on the side of a mountain, hunkered down, and there was a trail up above, and they were up there with flashlights going around. And they were saying, you could hear them talking, and they were saying, we know they're around here someplace. And we didn't realize it, but we had run slightly out of our area of operation, and there was an arc light scheduled to go in there.
Whoa.
And it went off while we were on the side of the mountain. You know what an arc light is?
Right, yeah.
A flight of B-52s dropping 500-pound bombs, right, in a pattern. And, I mean, I was holding on it was like being in an earthquake. And, I mean, fortunately, we weren't farther down. We weren't actually under the bombing, but we were close enough that, you know, and it scared the NVA off. And so they took off, and we were able to get out the next morning. And but that was quite the experience, yeah.
Oh, I'm sure. Now, to ask you a question about the last question about wiretapping, I had heard that with the NVA, with their field phones, that even though that they were on the hook, that you could they were always on. Is that?
That sounds right. But yeah, we came back and complained a lot because they assured us, oh, you can't. These are better. In fact, the very last mission they asked me to do was in a place called the golf course.
Right. I've heard of that. Yeah.
Yeah. And they wanted me to go in and tap another wire. And I said, I'd never turned down a mission. And I wasn't sure about this one. And I mean, for one thing, they could see you coming for miles because it was like the reason it was called a golf course because it was flat and grassy and just wide open. And they had found another coax cable running through a stand of woods. And I wondered sometime who finds these things, you know, it's where. So they wanted me to go in and do a tap on it. And I was trying to figure out how we could get, I was thinking about doing a halo jump into it with a very small team, and then they cut off cross-border operations and stopped them. I wasn't unhappy about that.
Oh. First OV-10 encounter.
OV-10.
Covey was usually in a little OV-1 and OV-2 aircraft, had a couple of rockets, no guns, so had limited tactical capability. So that was your first, I guess they helped you a little bit.
The guys who flew the little push pulls and whatnot, they were all ex-fighter pilots or something. You know? So they'd stop in dock tow and get rid of the marking rockets and put HE in and stuff. But, you know, they only carried like four rockets, two on each wing. I mean.
Right.
And there really wasn't much they could do. So we were going along this side of a ridge one time, and we came into this camp, NVA camp, and nobody was there, but all their gear was there. And we heard them. There was a stream down at the base of the hill, and they were down there. We could hear them chopping wood hear them talking, and they were splashing around. There may have been a pool or something down there. But so they weren't paying any attention to what was to us up top. So we went through all their gear, right, looking for documents and maps and wow. whatever. And so then we realized that they would certainly notice, you know, these things missing when they came back. So we called up Cubby and we said, hey, can you get some air support up and hit these coordinates? And Cubby came back and he said, oh, no problem, I'll take care of it. And, you know, we've left the camp and we're on the side of the ridgeline again, heading out. And we're like, what's he going to do?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, this thing comes screaming down the valley. And, oh, firing rockets. And I think they had cannon or Gatling guns up in the nose. And I mean, just this thing goes flashing by. And we were like, what was that? And that was the first time they started using those a lot for Cubby.
Did you ever meet that pilot?
No. It was interesting. Rarely ever met guys like the A1E pilots or and whatnot. And I did one time at one of the SOARs. The SPAD Pilot Association had come to, and I was talking with one of them, and this was actually the mission that I was talking about, the wiretap.
Right.
And it had a code, Air Force code name was Green Cape. And this guy was saying, he said, Green Cape. He said, what about Green Cape? And I said, well, I was on Green Cape. And he said, I was flying support for Green Cape. He said, I was bombing the ridgeline. So he was one of the pilots. And that was a very rare thing to ever actually. And even they said, you know, they would come in and do something, but they rarely knew what the results
were. Right.
You know, so that was kind of unique, meeting the guy who had, and I told him, I said, well, you saved our butts that day. So
you bought him a beer, did you?
Oh, I would have bought him whatever he wanted.
So I see that we've been talking for 53 minutes. Do we have time for one more story, one more event? Is that okay?
Sure.
Okay.
Anything in particular?
Well, I'm just going down your list. It's all on you. A valuable lesson. I was now officially the 1-0 running RT Texas.
Yeah. It's like anything, you know, whether it's a company or something, when you're coming up and you always, I would have done it differently. I could do it, but, you know. So I got to be the 1-0, right? And my first mission I knew my stuff. I'd been on a lot of missions. I'd been a radio operator, a 1-1, and you know, the whole, I'd done all of it. So, but suddenly you're on the ground, and you look around and everybody's waiting and they're all looking at you. Mm-hmm. And that's when it hits you and you say, well, they're waiting for me to decide what to do, to tell them where to go, to what, you know, and so, you know, everything was fine. Right. We went off, I took a breath and came back and I was talking to one of the old guys. This guy had been around a long time. He was probably a World War II vet. And I was talking, we were in the bar at the bar, and I was telling him about it. And I said, man, I said, suddenly hit me. I, you know, it was all on me. If I screwed up, you know, I'd get somebody killed or something. And if I made the wrong decision. And he said, let me tell you something. He said, your guys are well trained. You've been well trained. He said, the worst thing in the world is not making a decision. He said,
I heard that before.
Whatever you do, he said, make the decision. Right, wrong, or indifferent. He said, your training will probably carry you through it. They said, but if it's a really bad decision, then there won't be anybody to blame you anyway. So you'll all be dead. But he said, the worst thing is not making a decision. And I carried that with me all my life. And I remember sitting in boardrooms. I did a presentation to a bunch of board level people in a company. And I was asking if they were, you know, it was, I don't know, a $20,000 or $30,000 decision. That was, now these guys collectively are making millions of dollars, right, on this board. And I stood there and watched them. It was like a hot potato tossing the decision around the room to each other. And nobody would actually make the decision, you know? And it just always make a decision, you know? You're getting, that's why you're getting the big bucks, make a decision, you know? But so, you know, I've always been one to go ahead, you know, when something happened, make a decision, make the call. And then, you know, if I call it wrong, well, then I'll own up to it, you know. But I remember one time, this last thing, I ran this IT department, and I heard a couple of guys arguing, and I outside my office, and I told them to come in, and I said, "What's the argument about?" And they said, "Well, you know, this and that," and you know, two or three people got involved, and they're going back and forth. And I said, "No, we got to do it." I said, "Tell me something." I said, "If this doesn't happen this way," I said, "who's going to die?"
Yeah.
And they said, "What? What are you talking about?" I said, "If this doesn't happen or does happen, whatever it was," I said, "who's going to die as a result?" They said, "Well, nobody's going to die." I said, "Okay, then we can downgrade it a level.
Right.
We'll take it from there. You know, everybody calm down and we'll figure it out."
Well, I mean, that's a great, those tools are great. You know, I told my kids, you know, like, if you have to make a choice, use an educated choice, and don't go on like your, you know, emotional choice, you know. Or you can think about the worst case scenario and the best case scenario, find somewhere in the middle. At least you've weighed up your options, right? What is the worst? Yeah. Similar thing to you. Hey guys, is someone going to die from this? No. Well, then why are you getting so elevated? Right.
Yeah.
But we're right. Can you believe that, John? We're right on the dot of an hour. So I'm hoping that in the future that you'll come back. I mean, if there's so many more things I want to ask you, and your friendship, and you know, with Bill as well. I mean, there's a huge tie in there we haven't got into, and lots more about how you got one of your team members back, your Indige, you know, there's, that's a great story. So, and I actually sent Pio, is that his name? That's how to say his name?
Pio.
Pio. So I sent him the link to Bill's, podcast. And I said, he goes, "Oh, that was great." I said, "It'd be great to have you on there as well. Like the three of you, you know." He said, "Oh, it'd be the same story as John and Bill." I'm going, "Well, yeah, but like you're special, you know, so it'd be great, great to do that one day." So thank you very much for your time today. And hopefully that we'll see you again soon.
Okay. Thank you, Jason.
You're welcome.
The crow for day. I am the little red rooster. Too late, the crow for day.